Welcome to Maple Avenue Christian Church, a great place to connect, grow, serve, and share. We hope to today's service you'll connect with God and build community with Christ followers. Please use the online form to let us know how we can pray for you this week.
If you're with us in person, you can fill out a connection card.
To help us stay better connected, subscribe to our YouTube channel and follow us on Facebook. Don't forget to click the notification bell so you don't miss a thing. You can also contact the church office to be added to our email updates.
Here's what's going on at MACC.
Thanksgiving is a great time to be the church for our community.
There's a big need this year.
We need more than 100 more baskets.
Please consider how you could help. Our Christmas decorating party will be Wednesday, November 18th,
from 5:30 to 7:30.
We will deck the halls and have lots of fun.
Soup and sandwiches will be served.
Today we have with us Sam Levine. He's a candidate for the youth ministry position. Take a moment to greet him today.
Don't forget to sign up each week for the service you plan to attend. This helps us manage our building capacity.
Thanks for being patient with us as we move forward safely.
Thanks for worshiping with us today.
Be sure to check out our website,
follow us on Facebook, and subscribe to our YouTube channel to stay updated throughout the week.
But for now,
can't say we didn't tell ya. Jinx, you owe me a Coke.
We stand as we worship God in song this morning.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain moved. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. Nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see an empty tomb. So when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
God, we're so grateful that you go before us, you fight for us. We don't have to fear, we don't have to worry, because you have everything in your hands. We worship you for your might and your power. No matter what we're going through in our lives, God, we trust you. We trust that you'll take care of us, that you'll provide for us. We thank you for your son. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
There's a table that you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body, your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battles. There's a table that you've prepared for me. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. In the valley, I know that you're with me. And surely your goodness and your mercy follow me. So my weapons are praise and thanksgiving. This is how I fight my battles. And I believe you've overcome, and I will lift my song of praise for all you've done. This is how I fight my battles. 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 This is how. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battle.
Would you please be seated as we prepare for our time of communion?
Good morning. I was told recently that every blood and platelet donation saves up to 3 lives. I know there are several in our church, including myself, that donate on a regular basis. Many lives are being saved because of our willingness to give. Jesus gave his life and blood not to save our physical lives, but to save our souls, to save us from our sin. Isaiah 53:5 says, "But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed." We are healed from the wounds caused by our sins. John 1:29 says, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." So as we take the bread and the juice, let us remember that it is Christ's blood that takes away our sins and saves our souls. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come together to celebrate your death on the cross, not because it's a celebration, because it's a celebration of your love for us, Lord, and that it was your act of love that saves us, that takes away our sins, something that we cannot do on our own. So we take the bread and the juice and remember your broken body, Lord, and your shed blood, and that you gave all for us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Many of us are blessed in so many ways, Lord. Some of us give beyond what we are expected to give. I just pray that you would change our hearts and know that the gifts that we give are blessing your kingdom, Lord, here in Macomb and throughout the world. I just thank you, Lord, for the life that you have given us, Lord, through your Son. And that we would remember to give in many ways, that our lives will be blessed through that. Amen.
Would you please stand? As you leave today, you'll have an opportunity to drop your tithes and offerings at the buckets at the end of each of the section.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. I will follow where you know I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. When you go, I'll go. When you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
Seated at this time.
Good morning and welcome to Maple Avenue. We're glad you're here to worship with us. And if you're watching us online, we're glad that you're tuning in to worship with us and pray that the Holy Spirit will truly bless your worship time. And if you're here with us, this is a time where we invite you to take off your mask if you're comfortable with that while we're going through this, and then we'll ask you to put it back on at the end of our service. This morning, I want to take just a moment and introduce Sam Levine to you guys. Sam is from Tucson, Arizona, and so we welcomed him to the blistery Midwest yesterday. He came. Sam is interviewing for our youth ministry position here at Maple Avenue, and so I just want to take this time to remind all our junior high and high school students to come out tonight. Parents of junior high and high school students, we want to invite you as well. And all our youth group volunteers, want to invite you guys to remember that we're meeting together tonight at 6 o'clock. It's just a time where you can get to know Sam. He's going to share a little bit about himself and his vision for youth ministry, things like that. So I want to encourage you to come and be a part of that. I'm not going to make him talk right now, but Sam, thanks for coming up here, and you get to see who he is. So make sure you greet him after our service this morning. You know, guys, we've got Thanksgiving and Christmas. They're just right around the corner. And just want to remind you, don't forget that we still need help with distributing those Thanksgiving baskets that we're going to be doing next Sunday. So go ahead and plan for that. That starts at 1 o'clock. So if you come to first service, don't forget to come back and help us out with that. But this is one of the largest responses we've ever had for our Thanksgiving baskets. 215 families. So 215 households have said, you know what, we could use some help. And that's really not a huge surprise with COVID and all the things that have been going on and some people out of work. So thank you to you, this church family. Thank you to many of the folks in the Macomb community who have called and said, hey, we want to help. Also, a great number of our teachers have stepped up and said, hey, we want to help with this. So it's just a real community effort. And you guys, because of your generosity, your love, your grace, your mercy towards others, man, you're spearheading this. And so thank you. But we still have a lot of work to do. We have to pick the turkeys up on Sunday. We've got that covered. We've got to distribute all those bags. So we're just going to need some help here, and we'll lay out all the instructions for that next Sunday at 12:30. So if you're going to help, I need you here at 12:30. We start at 1. If you're going to help, listen, be here at 12:30, not 12:31, not 12:35. Donnie's going to start instructions at 12:30 sharp. So be here. I don't like to repeat myself. It's just a waste of my time. So be here at 12:30, please. And Anyway, thank you guys for all that. But with all these holidays that are coming up, you know, Thanksgiving's just around the corner, so is Christmas. I'm sure many of you are expecting to maybe have visitors come to your home. You know, every year, my wife and I, we open our home up, and my brother and his family come. My mom comes up from Kentucky, and we get to spend time with all of them, and it's always a fun time. So I'm sure some of you are like that. You're getting ready. You're getting your home ready, and you probably go through different things as you're expecting visitors to come. Maybe you clean a little cleaner than you usually do. Maybe you go out and you buy certain foods that you don't normally buy. You know, you want to prepare that person's favorite food. You just want to be the good host or hostess, you know, and invite people into your home. I'm just going to make a disclaimer real quick. When I say the word host, I'm talking about host or hostess. So don't get upset if I don't say hostess enough. It's just quicker to say host, but I just want to lay that out there. So anyway, we do all those things. Maybe we change the beds finally, you know, more than once a year, and we get ready for all that. So just expecting a lot of people. This year, we're actually going to be guests at my brother's home. We're going to meet down in Mahomet and spend Thanksgiving with them. And so we're going to be going to someone else's home. So some of you may be like that. Maybe you're getting ready to go to someone's home. And when you go to someone's home, some folks, you know what you can expect. You know that they have done all the preparation to make your stay just outstanding. They're the kind of people who turn your bed down. They put the little chocolate mint on your pillow, and you love going there. They just do all those little things, you know. One of the things that, you know, maybe they get out those smell good candles, and they burn those, and the house smells, and it masks all the other odors that are maybe lurking around. But when I was several years ago, I went down to Cincinnati. I was going to speak at the Stone Campbell Journal Conference in Cincinnati, and we stayed with James and Becky Snyder. Now, some of you know who that is. Becky is Cindy Jones's sister, and for those of you who don't know Cindy, Cindy was our secretary here for about 10 years. I hired her about 4 months after I started and just had her, just a great time with her, but she was on staff here. But anyway, Becky and Cindy are sisters, and so when we were going to Cincinnati, she arranged it so we could stay at Becky's house. And I'm going to tell you, Becky Snyder is a gifted hostess. She is awesome at that. When Kelly and I arrived at their home, it was so relaxing. I guess I would describe it as comfy chic, if you will. That's Becky's style. She took us up to the room we were staying in. She had all the toiletries that we would ever need, that an army of people would ever need, just available at our disposal. We didn't need them, but she had them there anyway. It was so thoughtful. On the bed was a basket of Skyline chili. Now, if you're not from Cincinnati, they may not mean a whole lot to you, but in Cincinnati, Skyline chili is like the bomb. It's just chili with cinnamon sprinkled in it, and people go nuts for it. It's okay. Kyle, I think, is a huge fan of Skyline chili. So there are people who just lose their mind over it. And there's all kinds of various other things in that basket. It was just very talented at that. That was just a great gift of hers. This morning, we're going to continue on in our series called Giving Church. And last week, we spent a lot of time talking about financial giving, which is something that we have to talk about as churches. We don't shy away from it here at Maple Avenue, because financial giving is just one aspect of giving. We're going to talk about giving in a different way. We're going to talk about giving of ourselves, giving of our home, giving of our time and our talents in this one little word called hospitality. It's one of those key things that Scripture talks about. It's a real trademark of a Christ follower. It really is. So if you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to turn to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 16, beginning in verse 5. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 5, and if you are able to stand, I want to invite you to stand as we read God's word this morning. And if you're not able to stand, don't. Stay where you are. That's fine. 1 Corinthians 16, verse 5. Paul continues in this letter, and he says, "After I go through Macedonia, I will come to you, for I will be going through Macedonia. Verse 6, perhaps I will stay with you for a while or even spend the winter so that you can help me on my journey wherever I go. For I do not want to see you now and make only a passing visit. I hope to spend some time with you if the Lord permits. But I will stay on at Ephesus until Pentecost because a great door for effective work has opened to me, and there are many who oppose me. Verse 10, when Timothy comes, see to it that he has nothing to fear. We'll talk about that. Why does Paul say that? You're going to visit a church? Why would you have anything to fear? But see to it, he has nothing to fear while he is with you, for he is carrying on the work of the Lord, just as I am. No one then should treat him with contempt. Send him on his way in peace so that he may return to me. I am expecting him along with the brothers. Now, about our brother Apollos, I strongly urged him to go to you with the brothers. He was quite unwilling to go now, but he will go when he has the opportunity. You can have a seat. What in the world does that have to do with hospitality? Well, we'll unfold this. Last week we said giving is ministry, right? That's the way we started our series. That's the way we started our sermon, saying giving is ministry. And then we talked about financial giving. So this week I want to talk about how hospitality is ministry. I truly believe hospitality is ministry. Hospitality can be defined as the quality or disposition of receiving and treating guests and strangers in a very warm and friendly and generous way. Okay? It's just one way it can be described. And just think about it for just a moment. Does that describe you? Does that describe you in the way you bring people into your home, in the way you invite people into your home? Does that describe you in hosting others who come to our church? When someone walks through the doors, are you this way with them? Every one of us, all of us. I mean, if you're in this room, I expect, our leadership expects, that this would be you. Don't look to somebody else to do this. This is something we all do. This is all of our responsibility. Just like giving is ministry and it's all of our responsibility, so is hospitality. It's what we're called to do. It's who we're called to be. Are we treating visitors? Are we treating guests? Are we treating strangers in a warm and friendly and generous way? Are we being generous to those who come in our doors? Three or four of us can't be generous, warm, friendly to everyone because there's so many others. So it takes all of us doing this together. In the New Testament, the Greek word for this is philoxenos, and that's a compound word. It's translated hospitality. It literally means the love of strangers. Philo comes from the word phileo, which is where we get that term brotherly love. So it's a brotherly love. Xenos is the Greek word for strangers. So it's a brotherly love of strangers. That's what hospitality is. That's what this means. Are we treating people that way? Do we have a brotherly love, a brotherly affection toward anyone who comes in our doors, whoever God brings in our life? Hospitality is a virtue that is both a command and it is commended throughout Scripture. In the Old Testament book of Leviticus, it was specifically commanded by God when he said, when an alien lives with you in your land, and I believe this is timeless. So when an alien lives with you in your land, do not mistreat him. That's the word of God. Look it up. I wish you would. Leviticus 19. That's an Old Testament book. Do not mistreat him. The alien living with you must be treated as one of your native born. Love him as yourself. For you were aliens in Egypt. And remember how the Israelites were treated in Egypt. For a time, it was treated well, but there was a time where they were treated as slaves. They were slaves, not just treated as slaves, they were slaves. And Moses went and delivered the people according to God. How we treat others matters in this country. How we treat others matters in this church. How we treat others matters in our home. How are we treating others? During his public ministry, Jesus and his disciples depended entirely on the hospitality of others. Every place they went, they depended on the hospitality of other people to open their homes as they ministered from town to town. When Jesus sent the 12 disciples out in Matthew chapter 10, verses 9 through 11, he told them to depend on the hospitality of other people, of the people in the town. Listen, here's how he said it. In verse 9 of Matthew 10, he said, "Do not get any gold or silver or copper to take with you in your belts. No bag for the journey or extra shirt or sandals or a staff, for the worker is worth his keep. Whatever town or village you enter, search there for some worthy person to stay at their house until you leave." You see, the early Christians, they depended on and they received hospitality from others. Listen to Luke's experience in Acts chapter 28, verse 7. This is an awesome experience that he had. He said, "There was an estate nearby." Now, Luke was traveling around with Paul, and he was on these missionary journeys, and he was watching, he was recording all that was going on as the birth of the church was coming about in the book of Acts. And he said, "There was an estate nearby that belonged to Publius, the chief official of the island. He welcomed us to his home and showed us generous hospitality for 3 days. In fact, travelers in ancient times, back in Jesus's time, back in Luke's time, Paul's time, they depended heavily on the hospitality of strangers. Not somebody they knew. I'm going to my brother's house. I know him. But a stranger. Imagine going into a town and depending on the hospitality of a stranger. Imagine somebody coming to this town and depending on you, a stranger, and your hospitality. Imagine a stranger coming into our church. How are they going to be received? But they depended heavily on the hospitality of strangers. You see, back then, traveling could be very, very dangerous. It could be very dangerous as you traveled. And there were very few inns. There were no Motel 6 at every exit, okay? There was no Holiday Inn Express, very few inns. And most of the early Christians, they couldn't afford to stay at one of those inns anyway if there was one. They just didn't have the financial resources to do that. So this generous provision to strangers also included opening one's home, not just for people to stay all night, not just to feed them a meal, but it also included opening your home for church services, for worship times where people would gather. Hospitality was indeed a highly regarded value in ancient times, especially for Christian leaders. The writer of Hebrews reminds us in Hebrews 13:2, he says, "Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by so doing, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it." In the book of Genesis, remember in chapter 18, we read of Abraham's humble and generous display of hospitality to three strangers. Remember that? Abraham could have called any one of his servants to take care of the needs of these strangers who were coming down the road. But no, Abraham saw them and he had compassion and he was hospitable. And so he himself, that's one of the interesting things about that story. He himself went out and provided hospitality, provided generous hospitality and care to these three strangers who were coming down the road. And yet the hospitality of this righteous Abraham, as he generously gave them the best he had. And as it turned out, he entertained the Lord and the angels, two angels. And I want to encourage you this week, just go back and spend some time in the book of Genesis. Read chapter 18. Let that be part of your devotion this week. Just tie that in with what we're talking about today. Spend some time exploring and thinking about how would I have entertained these three strangers, people I had never met before. Paul reminds us in Ephesians 2:10. He says, this is your responsibility as a Christian. He says, for we are God's handiwork created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. Listen, as followers of Christ, we emulate his love. We emulate his compassion when we show hospitality to others. Not just to fellow Christians, but even more so to strangers. Even more so to those who are less fortunate than ourselves. As Jesus said in Luke 14, he said, when you give a banquet, invite the poor. Invite the crippled, invite the lame, invite the blind, and you will be blessed. Here's what you need to understand about that. In Jesus' time, those folks who struggled with those physical ailments, they were the outcast of society. They were the ones that people turned their backs on. They were the ones that nobody wanted to spend time with. They didn't want to invest in them. And Jesus says, those are the folks you go to. Who are the outcast in our society today? Who are the ones who are outcast in our culture? Those are the ones. That's what he's saying. Invite them into your home. Don't turn them away. Love on people, provide for them. As God brings them into your life, provide for them. Jesus also taught us the second greatest commandment. In Matthew 22:39, he said, love your neighbor as yourself. Love the person sitting beside you as you love yourself. And the parable of the Good Samaritan, you know what that teaches us, right? It teaches us that our neighbor has nothing to do with geography. It's not who's built the house next door to you. That's a neighbor, but that's not the only neighbor we have. Our neighbor has nothing to do with citizenship. It has nothing to do with race. It has nothing to do with ethnicity. It has nothing to do with the economy. It doesn't even have anything to do with religious beliefs. You're to love them. Wherever and whenever people need us, there we can be neighbors. And like Christ, like Jesus, we can show mercy. I think that's something we're missing desperately in our culture today, is grace and mercy. We don't show a lot of grace and mercy. And I'm not talking about you folks in this room. I'm just talking about people in general. We just don't show a lot of grace and mercy. So let's be the people who show grace and mercy to others. Let's love our neighbors as ourselves. Let's be a hospitable people. Let's be a church that people want to come and be a part of. You know one of the biggest reasons why people return to churches and keep going to churches? It's not because of the preaching. It's not because of the songs. It's not because of the paint colors or the carpet colors or the comfortness of the chairs or any of that junk. You know what it is? It's the friendliness of the people sitting in the pew. Study after study after study has proven that. It's not the friendliness of the preacher. I mean, we got to be, but it's the friendliness of the people in the chairs. It's how we interact with others. And it's more than just, hey, how you doing? It's taking that time to say, you know what? I'm going to hurt with you when you're hurting. I'm going to cry with you when you're crying. I want to love on you when you need it. That's really awkward for a lot of us. I understand that. But it's what we each one of us has a responsibility to do for the other. So don't look around and go, well, they ain't never loved on me. Well, they ain't never said this to me. Ask yourself, when's the last time I went and loved on somebody in this church? It's just the thing, I mean, that's the teachings of Christ in this. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus discusses the hospitality or the hospitable behavior of those who will inherit the kingdom of heaven. So I want you to listen close to this. This is how we who inherit the kingdom of heaven will respond to others. He says, for I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. When people approach you and say they need something to eat, do you give them something to eat? Or do you go, oh, Jack, man, I have been fooled too many times. I'm hanging on to my Abraham Lincoln. He's staying right there in my wallet. Or do you take them to a restaurant, get them something to eat? I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. Doesn't take much. Glass of water. Give them something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. Do we invite strangers in or do we feel awkward and we step away? How do we do with that? I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. That's how Jesus describes those who will inherit the kingdom of heaven. And listen, I know there are some of you in this room, man, you feed those who are hungry. I know some of you give drink to those who are thirsty. I know some of you clothe those who are naked. I know some of you invite strangers in. I know some of you go and visit those who are in prison. I know there are many of you who look after those who are sick. Keep it up. It's what we're called to do. This is a loving church family, but I think there's always room for us to grow in that. There's always room for us to improve. And I also know that not every one of us does these things. Some of us do, but we could all be doing them. In these days, we often don't think much about entertaining strangers, but hospitality is still an important part of the Christian lifestyle, of Christian ministry. And by serving others, we serve Christ. As a matter of fact, here at Maple Avenue, one of our core values, which I want to share with you, we're going to have out there on that wall there as you come in those double doors pretty soon. We're going to have our logo. We're going to have our vision statement up there. We're going to have our mission statement up there. We're going to have our core values up there because we need to know what those things are. Those need to be ingrained into us. That's what we believe as a church leadership, and that's what we want to communicate to those who are coming in. But one of our core values is that we are crafted to serve one another. We believe that. We believe part of our responsibility is to serve others. That's what hospitality is about. It's about working hard and serving others. So we see here that hospitality is a ministry, and we believe that. So as a good host, providing hospitality to others, Paul reveals some truths that a good host will incorporate into their ministry as they serve others in this role to the Corinthians. And these are principles that I believe you and I can incorporate into our lives as well. So let's look at what the Apostle Paul lays out as responsibilities of a good host. So first of all, a good host provides the right help. They don't just provide help. Sometimes help can be a hindrance, but they provide the right help. Verse 6 can be so easily overlooked, but Paul is saying, I'll spend some time with you so that you can help me on my journey wherever I go. Now, let's keep this in perspective, okay? This is the last chapter of this first letter that the Apostle Paul writes to this church in Corinth. And all through this letter that Paul's writing to this church in Corinth, he's been answering questions, and he doesn't sugarcoat at all his answers. As a matter of fact, remember how he answered one of the things, how he summarized all this in 1 Corinthians 11:17? Paul said this, he said, in the following directives, I have no praise for you. This is what he's telling this church in Corinth. In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. Wow. That's what he's telling the whole church. Your meetings, your coming together, your worship does more harm than it does good. You talk about, Paul's talking to this whole church in this manner. I mean, wow. Could you just put yourself in the Corinthian sandals for a minute? Put yourself in their tunic for just a second. Imagine somebody stood up here and they said, Maple Avenue, your meetings do more harm than good. Now, I'm getting ready to come and stay with you, and I'm going to let you take care of me. How would you respond to that? Hey, man, you're telling me that my meetings do more harm than good, and then you want me to take care of you? Who are you, man? No, we ain't taking care of you. I'm sure maybe that crossed their mind a little bit. But Paul expects them. He expects them to help. So just put yourself in there and just think about that. And he doesn't just expect them to help. He expects them to give them the right help. The Corinthians, they welcomed Paul. They were good hosts. They helped Paul. We don't know exactly what kind of help they provided, but they were requested to help. They didn't let pettiness get in the way, or at least Paul doesn't expect them to be petty. He expects them and their hospitality to be helpful, to provide the right help. Help. Man, pettiness can keep us from serving others. Pettiness can keep us from loving others. Paul confronted them about sins going on in their life, and he didn't expect them to be petty about it. Let's be big boys and big girls. Somebody confronts us in our sin, let's not be petty. So as a church at large, or as a church in your homes, in our homes, our hospitality can provide the right help to others. When you open your home, listen, when you open your home, you are inviting others into your life at a very personal level. And the way you treat them, the way you minister to them, is an example of Christ's love. When we open our church doors, the way we treat others as they come in, not the way I've been treated, the way we treat others, okay? As Christians, that's the way we need to look at it. The way we treat others is a reflection of Christ's love to them. Some people may need you to sit and talk with them. Others, they may need you to provide them a meal. Others may need a place to stay. Some people may just need a shoulder to cry on. But we help according to their very real need. That's how we provide the right help. Same is true here in our churches. When we open our doors on Sunday morning, we have to meet those needs of people. And one of the ways we do that is, man, with our Thanksgiving baskets. That meets a huge need in this community. Largest number it's ever called, because people are struggling. Our Christmas Eve dinner. Now listen, it's not the dinner that they really need. You know what they need, most people? They need the time that we spend going into their home to deliver them that. That's why I always encourage our delivery drivers. We're not in a race. We're not trying to impress each other with how many deliveries an individual makes. Slow down. Spend time with the people we deliver to. Because some of them, you may be the only people they see through the holidays. That's being good hosts. Even if it's not in our place, we're providing that for others. We're meeting the needs of others. It's an opportunity to for all of us to provide the right help to those who come to worship, for those who are investigating us as a church, or those who are just checking us out, or those who are just drug along by somebody else. It's a great opportunity when people come in our doors for us to be good hosts. I can't tell you exactly what must be done, but as you step out of your concerns and you step into someone else's concerns, you will know what the right help will be. Okay, let me say it again. When you start to step out of your concerns and you start to step into someone else's concerns, you'll understand what the right help for that person will be. And if you're listening to the Holy Spirit, you'll provide that help, the right help. Well, the next thing the Apostle Paul says is a good host provides encouragement to others. Good hosts provide encouragement to others. In verse 10, Paul is preoccupied that his son in the faith, Timothy, has absolutely nothing to fear as he enters into the church at Corinth. Paul wants them to encourage Timothy. One of the scariest things a person encounters is visiting a church for the very first time. A new church, being a new person there for the first time. And that first visit and that first interaction with others can either intimidate us, it can scare us, or create fear in someone, or the church can be a great host and alleviate all the fear and provide encouragement through their hospitality. I'm going to talk to Sam after we're done this morning. I'm going to say, hey, first time here, what'd you think? How'd we do? You're getting graded today. This just happened to play out this way. God's awesome that way, right? So we're all being graded today. But anyway, hospitality and encouragement often go hand in hand. They just go hand in hand. The word translated encouragement is the Greek word paraklesis. And it's related to the word paraclete. And I've shared with you guys that word paraclete. That's the role of the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our lives. The paraklesis basically means to call, is a call to one side. It's when we come alongside someone. Paraklesis carries the idea of bringing someone closely alongside to exhort them, to encourage them, to give joy, to give comfort to them as they're journeying through life. And all of these actions, they make up this gift of encouragement. Interestingly, when Jesus conversed with his disciples on the night of his arrest, he spoke to them about the role of the Holy Spirit. Remember, he called him the helper, the comforter, the one who comes alongside, the paraclete. That's the role of the Holy Spirit, the one who comes alongside. A person with the spiritual gift of encouragement can use this gift in both public and private settings. Encouragement is useful in counseling. It's useful in discipleship. It's useful in mentoring. It's useful in preaching. And it's useful in hospitality. The body of Christ is built up in faith as a result of the ministry of those with this gift of encouragement. And if you are entertaining people in your home, and you want to have the kind of home that builds up others, which I'm sure we all do. We don't want the kind of home that tears down others. But if we want that, then we want to be that kind of home that encourages, that builds up others, that doesn't neglect the important ministry of encouragement. Imagine people coming into our church building. And imagine none of us hosted them well by encouraging them. How long do you think they would stay? I know some of you stand behind the excuse, well, I don't really know them. Then get to know them. There's nothing stopping you. Just get to know them. Maybe you're new and you're like, well, I don't know anybody. Then get to know them. There's introverts, there's extroverts. If you want somebody to get to know you, if you want relationships, step out of your comfort zone and get to know them. Get to know people. Take the initiative. Talk to others. If everybody has the mindset, well, nobody's talking to me, then nobody's going to talk to nobody. That's just what's going to happen. So get to know them. Some people, they say, well, you know, it'd be embarrassing to ask somebody their name when I should know it, so I'll just avoid them. Let me just ask them, be serious. Does that make sense? No, it doesn't make sense at all. When I was serving at another church, we had four services every week. And there was a couple. And I went up to them. I was like, hey, is this your first time here? Now, mind you, I'd been there 4 years. I was like, is this your first time here? They didn't know. Been coming about 10 or 12 years. I was like, now, I could have been embarrassed. But what I did is I stuck my hand out and I said, well, it's about time we met. And then I tried to get to know them. That's just the way it is. I mean, you're not going to know everybody. So if you don't know somebody, get to know them. If we aren't taking the initial step, then why would we think others would take that initial step either? Don't put it off on others. I want to share with you my experience 2 summers ago. I was invited to a preaching conference, a retreat down in Louisville, Kentucky, by Bob Russell. He was a former preacher at Southeast Christian Church there in Louisville. It's one of the most encouraging times I have ever encountered in my life. It really was. It was almost overwhelming. As soon as I pulled up and I got out of my vehicle to go in and check in, I had 4 people come up on me. One of them was wanting to carry my bag. One of them was wanting to park my car. 2 of them were wanting to walk me in. One was shoving cookies in my mouth. I liked that person. I was like, just take them. But, I mean, they just were loving on you as soon as you pulled up. And you just wanted to be there. Now, at first, I'm not kidding. I was like, whoa, slow down there, folks. But it's because they just loved on ministers that week. And it was awesome. There were 8 of us, and there were like 20 people there serving. It was just amazing. That's the kind of atmosphere we want to create here. But you know what that takes? It takes each and every one of us developing that kind of mindset, praying, God, show me how I can be hospitable to others. Show me how I can truly invest in others beyond the surface, good morning, how you doing? How can I truly be hospitable to others? Finally, I got to hurry up here. Finally, Paul says, a good host provides a peaceful place. I don't want to miss this. Man, this one's huge. Paul says in verse 11, send Timothy on his way in peace. Send him on his way in peace. A host provides a peaceful place. What we must remember is that there was a lot of animosity in Corinth. A lot of anger. There's still division. Paul's letter here didn't magically make the church unified, didn't magically make all the things go away. Paul actually had to write a second letter in which he deals with a lot of the same issues in the second letter as he dealt with in the first. So Paul's instructing them to make sure Timothy is sent peacefully. That's a big deal. There's nothing like having a peaceful place to get away. Some people retreat to the mountains, some to a cabin by the lake, some in the desert places. The thing is, we all want peace. Well, most of us want peace. I am so convinced that there are those who don't like peace at all. They don't like it for themselves, and they don't want anyone else to have peace, and they'll do all they can to disrupt unity and peace and love, and the reason is because they're not at peace with themselves. Until you're at peace with God and yourself, you're not going to be at peace with others. But that's another sermon for another day. I'll give it to you sometime. But here, Paul wants the church to be a place of peace. And I know I want Maple Avenue to be a place of peace. I'm not saying we're not. But I want to make sure that we are. If we're not intentional about it, we might slip. It's in peace that we can heal. And there are a number of people who come here so they can heal. It's in peace that we can grow. And the whole point of following in our relationship with Jesus is so that we grow as his disciples. It's in peace that we can mature. It's in peace that we can rest. The world places a priority on inner peace, and it offers thousands upon thousands of suggestions for those who seek peace of mind and peace of soul. And it's all about the external things. And there's much talk of meditation and finding your inner light and all this other stuff. If we need any help from outside ourselves, worldly wisdom says that we get it from a spirit guide or perhaps from crystals or herbs or all these other things. The problem with such advice, besides the obvious that it's witchcraft, is that it is completely ignores the source of true speech, true peace, which is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And the Bible has a lot to say about peace. Jesus is called the Prince of Peace in Isaiah. Paul refers to the God of all peace in Romans and in Galatians. So what exactly is peace? And how can we have inner peace and know how we can help as host with that peace? There's a Greek word in the New Testament called eirene, and it's often translated as peace. And it actually means to tie together as a whole, when all essential parts are joined together. Inner peace, then, is a wholeness of mind and heart and soul at rest. Inner peace has little to do with the external surroundings. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid." So as hosts, we should provide an environment for others in which they know that there is no external turmoil. Jesus told his disciples, he said, "In the world you'll have many troubles, but take heart. I have overcome the world." So peace is not the absence of trouble. Peace is the presence of God. Peace is not the absence of trouble. Peace is having the presence of God. Does your home provide others the opportunity to experience the presence of God? Is that what people experience in your home? Do you help us as a church provide others the opportunity to experience the presence of God? Or are you back there stirring the pot? Peace is fruit of the Holy Spirit. When the God of all peace comes to live inside us, a believing heart, he begins to produce his own characteristics in that life. Inner peace comes from knowing that circumstances are temporary and that God is sovereign over all. Peace comes from exercising faith in the character of God and his word. Listen, we have a chance. We can have peace in the midst of challenges when we remember that all things work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. We can choose peace rather than give way to fear and worry. Inner peace results from a relationship with God, and it allows us to keep things in order in proper perspective. Listen, we're commanded to live in peace with others as far as it is up to us. And Jesus said in Matthew 5:9, he said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God." And James said, "Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of peace." God desires us to live at peace with one another, to live at peace with our enemy as far as it depends on us. It's what God wants for those who claim his name. Listen, the stewardship of hospitality, it's important. The ministry of hospitality is important. The individual believer and the church family must constantly ask, what opportunities is God giving us today to use hospitality? What opportunity is God giving me today to use hospitality? And then do I have the courage to do so? I want to invite you, if you would you stand, put your mask on, and let me close this with prayer. Father, we want to take this time just to acknowledge that you have laid out for us the greatest example of what it means to be hospitable. You created the heavens and the earth, and then you created us, and you placed us here. You provided everything we could ever need or want in your creation. And we thank you for that. God, you have also shown us what it means to welcome those you love and those who are your enemy. We loved you, At first, we sinned against you and turned against you, and still you welcome us. You are the greatest host. So, Father, help us to learn from your example. Help us to be the kind of host that brings honor and glory to your name. Help us to be a hospitable church. Help us to be the place where people can come and be at peace, where people can come and be encouraged, where people can come and find the right help so that they grow in that relationship with you. God, we thank you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Folks, while you're standing and your mask on, we're going to close our service out a little bit different today. We're going to give you time. We're going to be playing up here. And while we're doing that, we just want to ask that you just spend some time greeting each other this morning. Now, I know we've got to socially distance. I know we have to do all that. But just spend some time with each other this morning, just a few minutes while we're playing, and then we're going to close with a song. So don't leave till we sing this song together. But we want to invite you. So go ahead, disperse, and greet each other.
Would you all join as we sing this together? I know you know this.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm part of the family of God. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm part of the family of God.
Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and may he make his face shine upon you and give you his peace. Just as a reminder, the ushers will dismiss you from back to front. Have a great week.